I call the Honourable Member for Grayndler.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I'm humbled to be able to make a contribution to this very significant condolence debate and follow the generous and kind words of the Prime Minister, the Leader of the Opposition, the Deputy Prime Minister, the Deputy Leader of the Opposition and others who've made a contribution. I begin by expressing my condolences to Tony, who of course was a former Federal Labor member for Grayndler as well, to Nicholas, to Stephen, to Catherine, to their partners and to their family. Gough Whitlam was a giant of Australians. He was a great parliamentarian, but also a great citizen. At a time where much of political debate is in the weeds and the details, he soared above the political landscape as a figure in Australian politics. He both anticipated but was able to create the future by his actions. He was someone who, whether in a small room, at a dinner or at a public event, everyone else seemed to fade to black and white, while this giant of a man physically, intellectually, appeared there in full colour and dominated wherever he was. He, I think, came to office with an extraordinary agenda. The Whitlam and Barnard government, of course, was the entire government for 15 days. Gough had 13 portfolios. In a rare sense of generosity, Barnard had 14. He worked on all the reforms that he could deliver without legislation, reforms that had been in the waiting, some of them, for 23 years. He ordered full diplomatic relations with China and ended relations with Taiwan. He withdrew troops from Vietnam. At that time, there were 7 young men incarcerated in jail for refusing to serve in Vietnam. He released them under the powers that were there for ministerial intervention, and they were released from jail. He reopened the equal pay case before the Conciliation and Arbitration Commission. He appointed Elizabeth Evatt to that commission. He also banned racially based sporting teams. Of course, the issue of the apartheid-based teams from South Africa were, at the time, very controversial indeed. Those short couple of weeks were a sign of things to come. And in 3 years, he did not waste a day. There were 3 years of enormous reform that transformed our nation into the modern Australia that we see today. His passing will have a huge impact on so many Australians because he had an impact on them. When Gough was elected, I was, living in Camperdown with my mum and my grandparents. I had got to hand out in 1972, as you did, as part of the faith in 1972, and I remember the extraordinary celebration that was there in my local community, where people, I think, had been thinking that Labor would never quite get across the line. And he made a difference. He made a difference. The changes to Social Security for my mum, who was on an invalid pension, he changed being on Social Security from something that was you weren't good enough to be a real member of society to treating people with respect. He transformed the health system by the introduction of Medibank, torn down when the Conservatives came back into office, but now essentially an article of faith in this parliament whereby no one can openly say that they're opposed to the universality of public health care. He changed education so it was based on merit, not how wealthy our parents were. His reforms sent a message to young people all over the country: dare to dream, be your best, aim high. And that was a call which was answered by many people on all sides of the chamber who are the first people in their family to go to university. He opened up internationally and saw Australia as not just an adjunct to the motherland based in London, but as a nation that could stand on our own two feet proudly. He recognised, of course, made the first major steps after the struggle of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Australians and their supporters. It was that image of Gough passing the red dirt through Vincent Lingari's hands that I think mark a turning point in Australian history with regard to taking the walk and the journey to full reconciliation with the first Australians. As Paul Kelly perhaps put it very eloquently in his song, "From little things, big things grow," and indeed they have indeed from that. And of course, in terms of the artistic community, he transformed the way that we see ourselves. Speaking of Paul Kelly, of course, 2JJ and recognition of youth music culture was a part of Gough's recognition. Of course, an area that has been inspired much of my contribution to this parliament has been infrastructure and urban policy and regional economic development, along with his dear friend and comrade Tom Uren, who is my mentor more than anyone else in political life. I spoke at the National Press Club 3 weeks ago, and I began that speech by quoting Gough Whitlam in 1972 at his Blacktown Civic Centre campaign launch, where he said, "A national government which cuts itself off from responsibility for the nation's cities is cutting itself off from the nation's real life. A national government which has nothing to say about cities has nothing relevant or enduring to say about the nation or the nation's future. Labor is not a city-based party, it is a people-based party, and the overwhelming majority of our people live in cities and towns across our nation." The fact that you can say so many of Gough Whitlam's quotes in 2014 and they are as relevant today as they were then, is indicative of just how far ahead of the game he was. And he was ahead of the game within our party as well. He understood that you had to take power away from the factional bosses on the national executive, those photos of him being excluded from the decision-making that was taking place within the party from the entrenched interests. And he reformed the Australian Labor Party and made it a modern political party at great cost to people who, of course, wanted him expelled from the Labor Party at that time. I think in terms of Gough Whitlam's legacies, he is someone who will be regarded very fondly indeed. As the Leader of the House said, there's no doubt that the events of the 11th of November 1975 will loom large over the debate about his legacy. On that day, my history teacher at the time, Vince Crow, walked into the history class at St Mary's Cathedral and announced that our Prime Minister has been sacked and our government has been overthrown. They were good people, the Christian Brothers at St Mary's. They understood class politics. And I was home very late that day, as there was a fair bit of activity in the city of Sydney. There were horses and people attacking the stock exchange. They were very turbulent times indeed. Mm-hmm. Gough Whitlam played a role in spite of the great injustice that had been done to the government. He played a role in keeping national cohesion then and beyond. He held a demonstration there 2 days afterwards, for which we were all excused from wagging class to go across to the domain that was our playground at school. At that time, he said, "Express your views through the ballot box." He was a great Democrat, was Gough Whitlam, and he'll be remembered for it. Can I conclude by saying that I think our legacy in terms of political contribution can be judged by the permanency of it. If you look at Gough Whitlam's great reforms, access to education being opened up, recognition of China, engagement in our life in the full cultural activities, removal of discrimination against women on the basis of race through the Racial Discrimination Act. All of these measures have stood the test of time. All of them were very controversial at that time. All of them very controversial at that time. So I think he leaves a great legacy to the nation. He taught us to be brave, brave about our reform ambitions, brave in the face of our critics, and unstintingly brave in the pursuit of the greatest ambition any of us can ever pursue, that is justice and opportunity for all. Yeah.